location and choreography. Technical elements are not as important here. In fact, the pairs are not even allowed to attempt a triple jump. There's a maximum of 3 lifts allowed and 1 throw jump. Other than that, this event is wide open and it's worth 2/3 of the total mark.
One of the newest teams on the circuit this year, Kyoko Ina and John Zimmerman, could become national U.S. champions.
Bumps along the way, nothing major, mainly just the fact that they are new partners together, learning each other's timing.
Well, it's not exactly been easy. They've only been together 6 months. We'll have their marks when we come back to Japan. Japan season continuing. We just watched Kyoko Ina and John Zimmerman of the United States, their first season together. Kyoko used to skate with Jason Dungeon. They were American champions.
Here's a look at their side-by-side double axel, which they performed very nicely. This team has been probably the busiest pair team around this year. Here's a look at what was supposed to be a throw triple style cow, and it turned into a double. And that is a timing problem that they have had struggled with all season. I think it's a matter of getting in that practice rink. They have been so busy. This is their fourth Pro-Am event, along with all the other Grand Prix events that they've skated. They
maybe
have had
too much competition and not enough
time,
practice. Yeah.
Very little time in the practice rink, which is what they need right now.
Well, they finished third at the Cup of Russia, second at the Trophée Lalique, and fifth at Skate America. So they've been showing some progress marks-wise, too. They certainly are at a disadvantage here, though. They are the leaders, but the two other teams still to skate. Including Mandy Wurzel and Ingo Steuer. Before Verozhnaya and Sigurlitsi, this team made it to the top of the world. Lausanne, Switzerland in 1997 from Germany.
And they're skating to Masquerade by Vanessa Mayne.
One thing we can point out in interpretive skating is that you can't use costumes and props. Some of the maneuvers that are illegal in eligible skating, those rules are gone. You can do whatever you want.
It's wide open here. This team has just recently turned professional this season, and as you can see, this really works for them. This is their niche. They have found it. They've always had difficulties in the past with nerves, and doesn't seem to be quite as much pressure in the pro skating world.
The headbanger to finish. Whoa, whoa! I would forget the mask if I was doing that. I'd wear a helmet. They're fabulous. Mandy Wurzel and Ingo Steuer, the best German pairs team ever.
And they're obviously extremely pleased with this performance. You could see right from the start, they were so confident, so sure of themselves, and it really came across well. Every single lift was unique, was original. There's a little jump over the back there. They just recently finished a Canadian tour with Elvis Stoiko, low in the landing there. But I think they're liking the fact that they no longer have to deal with the eligible rank. They're very happy as professional skaters.
Watch how close.
She was very close here.
Whoa.
That's just her costume hitting.
My goodness, I can't even watch that. And
the toughest part of that move, actually, believe it or not, is the landing. She's timing it so that as she's coming down, she hits the ice at the right time.
Wow. Mandy Wurzel and Ingo Stoya. 5-4 is the Japanese and Russian judges. Not exactly concurring with the rest of the dais. Presentation marks, 5-6 to 5-8. Wurzel and Stoya are now in the lead. But the world champions are up next. When we come back, the world championships set for Helsinki are still a couple of months away, but already this team, the prohibitive favorite in the pairs competition. They're the world champions, performing on a professional ice sheet in this pro-am in Japan. Elena Berezhnaya, Anton Sigurlitsy from Russia.
Chosen to use their long program they have been competing with this year as eligible skaters. Their second open event. This is the Masters event and won earlier this season. Beautiful triple twist to open.
These would not be the costumes they would use in Helsinki, however.
No, these are different costumes than what we've seen so far this season. Obviously, they've had to rework this routine to fit the rules here. You're not allowed to do side-by-side triples. They turn that into a double axel. She goes down. She's a little bit low on the landing with her shoulder. Lost her edge. Variation of a lift that they do in their long program. Thank you.
almost the same position they begin. Elena on top of Anton's skates. Berezhnaya and Sigurlitsy.
And they skated this performance very well, although in my mind I think Wetzel and Stoyer had the skate of the night and captured the essence of the interpretive free and what it is supposed to be. To me, this is just their long program with a few reworked elements here.
So may the ISU judges, as we see Elena go down, still be prone to rewarding technical difficulty and the elements instead of artistry.
Well, obviously, as you can see here, they have rewarded them for their technique. However, I don't think I'm in complete agreement here.
They still, as great as they are, aren't quite the professional level skater, are they?
They're not quite there yet. They still have just a little ways to go. Part of it, I think, is nerves. Once in a while, they get them.
But they win $50,000. Berezhnaya Sigurlitsy, the Japan Open champions. Here is someone who could take advantage, Brian Orser.
Well, the emphasis in the interpretive free is on skating skills, musical and artistic presentation with limited technical elements. The skaters are only allowed to perform four triple jumps and one combination of jumps. Brian is skating to Dear Father by Neil Diamond. Thank you. is a goosebump performance. Mm-hmm. This routine has signature piece written all over it.
Brian Orser's marks from Tokyo when we come back. Eight-time Canadian men's champion, eight in a row in the 80s, world champion in 87, Battle of the Bryans in 88. He's won everything there is to win and to be awarded in skating, and he still keeps making us tingle.
And he's getting better. This season, he is just on the top of his game. He is so smooth, and to me, this routine is what every judge should be looking for in an interpretive freak. Skated every single note, used every note in that piece of music, every highlight he used musically, like his backflip here, and he skated with such passion and emotion.
He likes this format as opposed to Kurt, and I think it's helping rejuice the competitive fire in Brian. You can say what you want about Brian Orser, the kind of a skater he has been and what he has meant for this sport, but he loves to compete. He always has. Look at the technique marks. That seems to be a little bit low. He's asking for them to be higher. Kind of mid-range, and maybe they're leaving some room. I'm not sure.
Well, he is the first skater to stay here, so I think they are holding back a little. To me, these are low.
Brian Orser. And here comes the clown himself.
And this number will tear the house down.
We saw it in Kitchener. It helped him win the Canadian Open. Here is the incomparable Kurt Browning. that or not. Oh, the sheer brilliance, and it's amazing how humor transcends borders. These Japanese fans love this.
So few skaters can pull off humor on the ice, but he is a natural in more ways than one.
On the next HBO session.
Kurt Browning at the Japan Open.
He debuted this routine at this year's Open in Kitchener to rave reviews, but it's gotten better. There are several more little nuances you can see throughout the routine, and that's what Kurt does best. He works with something until he just gets like this right here. Look at that.
I think what sometimes may be lost is because you're laughing so hard and watching his gestures and his face is the pure difficulty of what he does at the plate. It's Beckham-esque, like Gary Beckham, only with a lot more flair.
And we hope that the judges will recognize that and that he'll get credit for that. There was that triple-triple combination that he wanted to do in the short program.
And what an ending.
What an ending. I don't know how he does that.
And this is what the interpretive free skate should be like. Either those are the reindeers or the clown convention is in town. My goodness, he is incredible. Kurt Browning, 5-4, five fives. That is,
they didn't recognize it.
Maybe he feels that's what one of the judges looks like. Look at the presentation marks, though. There was so much technique there, I don't think they realized how difficult that was. Oh, well. And so now, another world champion in this field of world champions, from the four-time world champion Kurt Browning to Todd Eldridge, who captured his world title in Edmonton in 1996.
And Todd is skating to the impossible dream.
Thank you.
what kind of credit he gets, because he's obviously put in more technical difficulty than Kurt or Brian. Certainly one of the most powerful spinners, and he nailed some big jumps here. But as an interpretive free skate, is that what the judges are looking for? We'll find out.
Todd Eldridge, second after the short program. His marks in a moment. Todd Eldridge with some fans in Japan. In fact, fans all over the world. Had a lot of triple jumps in here, Barb, but did he need them? He popped that.
He had a triple lutz and a triple axel. Remember, there's a maximum of four jumps. I'm actually surprised that he went for the big jumps, because in this type of format, they're not supposed to be rewarded.
Unless, I guess, in the judge's mind, it comes in an important piece of the music.
It adds to the choreographic value. And obviously here they think so, because these are higher than Kurt's marks.
So Todd Eldridge with these marks moves into first place. Kurt Browning is second. Curious. And the man that Eldridge was trailing after the short program. I call him a man. He skates like one, but he's really a young boy still, 16 years old, just turned 16, Evgeny Plushenko, our leader.
Obviously going for the big elements as well. I remember seeing this routine for the first time at the World Championships last year in the exhibition, and we all sat stunned as we watched this, and we just couldn't believe the amount of natural presence and performance that he has at this young age.
On the play.
I think you could use one of Kurt Browning's red noses. What's better, Evgeny Plushenko's crazy bird, or Kurt Browning's clown, or Todd Eldridge's jumps?
Sportsnet Skating is brought to you by Ford, for now, forever. And by Bank of Montreal. It is possible.
What a gold mine in Russia. Alexei Mishin found Evgeny Plushenko from one of the poorer areas of his country. He called him a cheap chicken when he saw him. He said he was skinny, still not, has to put a little more weight on. But this kid, to this routine called Crazy Bird, ironically, is unbelievable.
Well,
at 16.
He's not cheap anymore.
He's
a little richer than he was last year, and he's also a little heavier. He's gained about 22 pounds this season.
And taller, too.
Yes, and I'm really surprised he hasn't struggled with his jumps more than he has this season. He's been very consistent. And this routine was great. He combined difficult elements with unique original footwork, with a little bit of showmanship. It really covered all the elements that I think they're looking for.
Much like Kurtz. And there's Alexei Mishin, whose ex-student who became world champion, Alexei Yagudin, skates next. Plushenko's marks with presentation will put him in the lead again. So Plushenko is first. Todd Eldridge is now in second place. And one skater to come. And he is the reigning world champion. He has been on a roll this season, although he comes into this event after not winning the Russian Nationals. 16-year-old winning. Remember, he's only 18. Here's Alexei Yagudin.
I'm surprised that he's actually skating his long program with the interpretive free here. Obviously, in competition, he performs up to 8 triples. He's not allowed to do that here today. They're only allowed 4, so he's going to have to skate through a few things.
Thank you.
several exhibitions and shows. He's a great show skater, so I'm confused at why he wouldn't have chosen one of his exhibition skates for this performance.
Evgeny Plushenko, undeniable talent and power. And I'm wondering if one of the reasons that he is using this free skate, it may not be psychological in the fact that he did not win the Russian Nationals with this, and maybe he's trying to lay this down again to send a message to his younger rival.
But in this type of format, this just doesn't work. This should be placed behind the rest of the skaters, behind Ryan Orser. Sure, it's a very strong skate, but as an interpretive skate, it's just not as original or unique as the other performances.
How do you interpret that, first of all? And then look at the technique marks were unbelievable. This is where the ISU judging is obviously favoring the amateur skaters.
Extremely disappointing. I don't know if we had a different set of rules from the judges or what, but this was not, to me, what this was all about. The judges obviously were looking for something that is different.
Plushenko deserved first, no doubt. But Kurt Browning fourth, let's get serious. Alexei Yagodin was second, Todd Eldridge third.